This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I can have what it says I can have. Today, I'm ready to receive the incorruptible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. Come, Holy Spirit, have your way in this place. Come, Holy Spirit, have your way in my life. I'll never be the same again. Come on. Never, never, never. In Jesus' name, amen. Best shout ever. Give a hand to Dave as he comes.
Well, thank you, Pastor Mark. And it has been Marie and I's privilege to be here with you this weekend. We thank God for the opportunity to share and to meet new friends everywhere we go. I do this about 250 to 280 days a year. This is my 13th year for doing this. And people say, how long have you and Marie been married? And I say, it'll be 49 years this coming June. They say, how have you been able to do that? And I say, well, the way it works in our house is if I'm home too long, she'll say, don't you have a trip coming up? So it works. And she goes with me about half the time. And she's a great lady. And she loves children. That's been her anointing and her call. And she's been a professional ventriloquist for over 40 years. And I tell people I'm the other dummy in the family. And my real job is to haul her and Henriette around to their engagements. You know, I've been fascinated with your pastor and his mom and dad for a long time. I told the staff yesterday, you have a great leader in Pastor Mark and his wife Robin, and great spiritual parents. You are blessed as a church. And I'll tell you, I know you know that, but when you travel as much as I do and go as many places as I do, I can tell you, you are most fortunate to have them as your leaders and your spiritual people that are over you in the Lord, according to Romans or Hebrews 13. We need people who are over us in the Lord. I have Pastor Mark Barkley, who is my pastor and in Midland, Michigan, and I hold myself accountable to him. He knows I'm here today, and I thank God for spiritual leadership, and I thank God for the Holy Spirit whoever lives and abides in us. I've looked at your website address, Make Jesus Famous, and as I thought of that coming this weekend, the Lord says, share with them your message on making Jesus irresistible. You see, making Jesus famous is about telling people who he is and what he came to do and why and all that, but making Jesus irresistible is the connection, because when they meet us, according to the Word of God, they should meet Jesus. That's been a challenge for me all my life. Lord, help me never to embarrass you. Help me not to give people regret for meeting a Christian. Help them, Lord, to see you in me. Gandhi said, I thought a long time about being a Christian until I met one. But I don't want that ever to be said about me. How about you? When they meet us, they should meet Jesus. People say, do you go to church? I said, I am the church. Where do you want me to go? Right? Are we not the church? I understand what it means to gather together. Forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. So this building is not the church. It's where the churches meet. The reason the Holy Spirit came was so that we could become mobile sanctuaries. So when they touch us, they touch the outer court of his presence. And we then introduce him to the one who lives in us. You see, if Jesus is not irresistible to you, he'll never be attractive to others who are looking at you. When I was a young man, there was an address that I got to know quite often. I went there quite often. It was 1702 Lincoln Way, White Oak, Pennsylvania. It means nothing to you. It didn't mean anything to me until October of 1964. I didn't go there because there was a house that had an address on the corner of Lincoln Way and Kelly Street. I didn't go there because there was a family that lived there. I went there because of the young lady that was sitting beside me lived there. It wasn't the address. It was the person who lived there. And I knew when I would arrive there, it made all kinds of good things happen in my life. One of the reasons that we gather together as the church, the mobile sanctuaries, is so that we together, and your pastor mentioned it, doing church together, doing life together. There are no perfect churches. They're just churches filled with forgiven sinners who now are chasing Jesus for the rest of their days on this earth so that we can live with him forever in eternity. And so she became very irresistible to me. She was not easy. She made it very difficult, if the truth be known. She was extremely popular in high school. She was the number one dancer in a school of 3,000. She was on American Bandstand a half a dozen times. And so there were suitors lined up. But one thing about life, you can have really what you want once you make up your mind to have it. If you want all that Jesus has to offer according to this book that you just made your declaration, there's only one person that can stop you from having it. And that's who you look at in the mirror in the morning. No other person could determine your happiness. No other person. Never allow people to determine the amount of joy, the amount of peace that you walk in, the amount of blessing that God has for you. And then I got a notice from the draft board. I was 1A. They were looking for me. So I joined the Air Force before I was drafted by the Army or the Marines and went off to Southeast Asia. And as I got on the plane, Marie says, "I really like you, but I'm not going to wait around till you get back. I'm young. I'm going to date." What a way to send a young man off to war. That can either discourage you or it can make you more determined. What is happening in your Christian life happens because it comes through the hand of God, through his filter to teach us he is more than a conqueror. He is more than I could ever dream to have. He is the irresistible one. So when I got home in 1966 in October, there was a rock and roll song that you and our generation will remember well. "My Boyfriend's Back and You're in Trouble." So I told Marie, I said, "You had 2 years and now you have no choice but me. She says, well, I think I have something to say about it. I said, say all you want. My mind's made up. See, my grandkids, they love the story. Now my great-grandkids are beginning to hear the stories. See, all of us have a story. And if we're going to share our story with impact, it only will happen when Jesus becomes irresistible to me, to where I want him more than I want my very life and my very breath. And then when people bump up against me, you know, when we go out in the marketplace, when people bump your bucket, your life, whatever's in there is coming out. And when they bump your bucket, may Jesus come out. That's why a soft answer turneth away wrath. The only thing that's going to make us different from the people that you will walk among tomorrow and the rest of the week is who lives inside. Now, how do we make Jesus irresistible? Well, he was irresistible. In Mark chapter 2, verse 16, it says, why does he eat with sinners? You know what Jesus answered? When they ask him, why do you eat with these publicans and sinners? What did he say? It's okay to talk to me. He said, because they have need of a physician. Those who think they've got it all together. Those who think that they are not in need of a Savior. I came for them, but they don't need it. They don't understand it yet. They don't know it yet. You see, when you walk among people, as I shared with the people that were here yesterday, I encourage people everywhere I go, get a little yellow sticky note and put this one sentence prayer on it. And it will change your life, and it will change the lives of many people who will touch your life. And that sentence prayer is, Lord, help me be sensitive to those you put in my life today. When we get born again, our regenerated spirit is a baby. It's an infant. That's what born again means. It was there, but because of the fall of Adam, it became dead. There was no life. Now it's alive again, but it has to be trained and developed. And one of the things, if you're going to make Jesus irresistible, is you have to train your spirit man to be sensitive to what's going on in the spirit world around you. You see, those who are dead in trespasses and sins, they don't have the answers. I mean, we've had over the last couple of days millions of people marching for all kinds of reasons, demonstrating for all kinds of reasons. Jesus does not need us to demonstrate for him. We simply need to demonstrate him. That's why I don't carry placards. I don't get caught up in crusades and issues and things. I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm just saying I have a calling higher than demonstrating about special fringe social issues. We have a kingdom calling. And our kingdom calling is to make Jesus so irresistible that people will want to say, what is the reason that you're so hopeful when half the country tonight is in mourning and the other half of the country is in celebration? I have a message for both of them. It's Jesus and him alone that is the answer. Friends, if America ever needed the church to come together around an issue, it's not the political scene. It's not the social scene. It is about Christ and Christ alone. If I'm going to carry a banner, that's the one I will carry. Now, we live in the real world and we do these things. But friends, I was sharing with Marie driving over here this morning. I said, my heart is so longing for the church to begin to talk about our mission, our calling, our reason for existence. And it's not about getting caught up in the things of this life. We go through this life, but if we're going to go through with impact, let's make Jesus irresistible because he's irresistible to me. For 8 years, we gave leadership on the north side of Chicago at the corner of Lawrence and Sheridan Avenue, an outreach center called New Hope. We dealt with primarily gangbangers, alcoholics, drug addicts, and prostitutes. Our church was 90% people coming out of those lifestyles. And I was walking down from the outreach center one day to the corner convenience store to get something. And as I came out, a young lady there looked like she's ready to deliver any minute. She said, "Mister, can you buy me something to eat?" I said, "Sweetheart, when was the last time you ate?" She said, "3 days ago. I said, "Where do you live?" She says, "Underneath the overpass on Lakeshore Drive." Everything she owned was in a shopping cart she was pushing. I said, "Let me see your arms." She said, "Why?" I said, let me see them. Hold them out like this. So reluctantly she did, and there were track marks all up and down her arm. She was a heroin addict. That little baby she was carrying was probably a heroin addict. I said, "Listen, I have a team up at the building." I said, "We're about to eat lunch. Why don't you come with me and you can eat with us?" And so she came with me. And she sat down kind of by herself, and I told the team, I said, "Let her alone for a little bit. Just let her eat." And so when she finished eating, she came over to me and she said, I want to thank you for this. She said, "Is there something I can do? I feel like I don't have any money to pay you, but I just feel like there's something, if there's something I could do." And I said, "Well, why don't you help the ladies clean up the tables? Why don't you do that?" And so she did. She was there for about an hour, and she came, and some of the team, you know, greeted her, and she came, and she said, "Can I come back tomorrow?" I said, "Absolutely. You can come back every day if you want." So she came back all week. On Friday, she had now developed a relationship with a couple of the girls, and they had been praying with her. She accepted Jesus. And she came to me on Friday afternoon, and she leaned down and she kissed my cheek and she said, "Mister, I can't thank you for being Jesus to me." That's not just my story. That's our story. That's how it works. That's the reason you do this. That's the reason that we come together. So tomorrow, if Jesus tarries, and we leave our house, and we have prayed that little yellow sticky note prayer, "Lord, help me be sensitive to those you're going to put in my life today," I guarantee you divine appointments will begin to invade your life. You'll touch a lot of people, and a lot of people will touch you. As the little lady pressed in to touch the hem of Jesus' garment, which represented his influence. When they touch the edge of our influence, our space. When I walk into a Walmart, I have trained myself before I leave my car to bow my head and say, "Father, thank you that I am now walking into Walmart as your representative. If there's anybody you want me to talk to, then you point them out to me. Then I also inform the enemy. I don't know if there are any other Christians in Walmart right now, but I just want to let you know you're no longer in charge. Your influence is finished. I'm here now. The Godhead lives in me, and I take authority over anything you've been trying to do to anybody in Walmart. Now, friends, when it becomes that specific for you, I've shared that with corporate executives who are frustrated with things going on in their businesses. And I said, do you bow your head at your steering wheel before you walk into your place? Well, I prayed, but I said, no. Do you bow your head and take authority over the forces that are causing you grief? You just shared with me the things that are happening in your business. I said, as a Christian leader and businessman, you don't have to put up with that. We don't have to tolerate the enemy. See, what you tolerate, you will not change. What are you tolerating in your life that needs to change? Well, just don't tolerate it anymore. The enemy's going to invade your life until you do no longer give him the privilege to do so. The enemy has no right in my life. Now, it doesn't mean he's not going to try to come, but he has no right there. You talk about rights? Let's let the church let people know that we don't have to allow the enemy to act up in our country. We don't have to do that. This is not about politics. This is about the enemy having a field day when he can divide people. And he divides homes and he divides families and he divides, because that's his mission. He brings division. You see, nobody will be ever my enemy. I don't permit you to be an enemy of mine. I may be yours, but you're not mine. That's part of the irresistible nature of Christ, is because they may hate you. They may say all manner of evil against you. They may revile you. But we don't respond in kind. We respond because when somebody bumps our bucket, may the love of God splash out all over them. Now, I'll tell you, you can't do this with your mind. You can't do this in your own willpower. You may for a while here and there, but unless the Holy Spirit lives and abides in you, because this is not about being natural. This is about being supernatural. Now, let me give you three other verses. Is that the time on the back there? Okay, good. I've got a lot of good elevator speeches. If you can't say the purpose of your life in 3 minutes, you haven't figured it out yet. Okay? If somebody asks you, why are you on this earth? And if you can't tell them in 3 minutes clearly, then you're not sure yet yourself. In World War II, the United States soldiers were told, if somebody comes out of the night and you don't know whether they're friend or foe, if they can't tell you who they are in 30 seconds, shoot them. They were given permission. That was the rules of engagement in World War II. A little different in Vietnam, I can tell you. But let me give these. This is what's going to help you make Jesus irresistible. Psalms 110, verse 7. He shall drink of the brook in the way. Therefore, he shall lift up his head. Providing refreshment to people when they touch our life is number one. Do people feel refreshed when they walk away from us? That's why you don't dump on people. Now, all of us need somebody that we can go to and confide in prayer parties. But what I'm talking about is when we're out there and we're walking among the lost and the hurting and the broken, when they touch us. I was kind of struggling with our bags at the airport because I had to, I wasn't about to, you know, we had to bring some extra bags on this trip. And so I said, Marie, I'm going to get a cart and I'm going to put you here. Then I'm going to go get our rental car because we're leaving this afternoon going to Florida for work. And I said, when I get the car, I'll come back and pick you up. So I came back. I couldn't get to the curb lane. They had the cones out, but I'm out on the second lane, and I'm starting to grab these suitcases. A couple of them weighed over 50 pounds. And there was a young lady sitting on a bench there. And she jumped up and she said, Mister, can I help you? I said, that'd be wonderful. And so she helped me load all my luggage. And I reached in my pocket and I said, I want to bless you. And I gave her $50. I mean, her eyes went about like that. Oh, Mister, I said, no. The Lord told me to bless you. And I want to bless you. I mean, she hopped and skipped back over to her friend who was sitting on the bench alongside her. Guess what he gave, you know. That's not a big deal, is it? When God directs you. See, that was a divine appointment. How many times have you been at the airport and a stranger says, can I help you load your bags into the car? They have the red caps and others there. That when you arrive and you're dropping them off, but I wanted to refresh her. I wanted, you know, I thought, well, maybe $5, $10. I'm looking for a $20. Lord says, give her $50. You know when God's talking to you. That verse in Psalms, I believe, is a prophecy of when Jesus had just battled in the garden and was on his way to the cross of Calvary, and he was stepping over the brook Kidron, and he reached down and he took a drink. Therefore, he lifted up his head. He was able to go and pay the ultimate price for us. We need to refresh people when they touch our lives. Second, Isaiah 32:2. And a man shall be as a hiding place from the wind and a covert from the tempest, as rivers of water in a dry place, as the shadow of a great rock in a weary land. Not only do we need to be a brook in the way for people, we need to be a rock in the sand for people. This verse is talking about those that were living in desert areas to keep the shifting sands. They would place a rock in the sand. And if you place a rock in the sand, even in the deserts, and leave it there long enough, on the leeward side, the side away from the wind, green shoots will begin to spring up. We need to be a rock in the sand for people to keep the shifting sands of their life from blowing away totally everything. And we need to stay as a stable support in their life until the green shoots of growth begin to happen. Don't give up on people easily or quickly. If I'd have listened to Marie's suitors, if I'd have listened to Marie, I wasn't. Because when I saw her stand up on a Sunday night from the altar at age 15 and turn around, she was a different girl. I knew then, I said, that's who is for me. We need to be that in people's lives. Marie spent most of yesterday with a young lady who's, her and her husband moved to Peachtree City from our city to take a new job. And they heard that we were in the area. And because Marie is kind of like a mom, they wanted to spend some time with her. Because Marie has been a rock in their life and many other young women. We need to be a brook in the way and a rock in the sand. And last, Isaiah 30, verse 21. Whether we turn to the left or the right, your ears will hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way, walk ye in it. You know, we can either condemn the sinners, we can criticize the saints, or we can make up our mind to make Jesus irresistible to people. And I pray this morning that we will resist criticizing the saints and condemning the sinners. But we will look beyond that and see just how much we can impact lives if Jesus in us, the hope of glory, if he's irresistible to us, he will make you, regardless of what this outer package looks like, he'll make you attractive to other people. And they will come to you and say, what makes the difference in your life? What makes you who you are? And you'll be able to introduce them to Jesus. What is burdensome about that? All we have to do is represent and introduce and be Jesus to people. God bless you this morning.